9/11 was one of the worst days of my life, not for the traditional reasons of the people I lost, although I lost some friends and close associates, but because I was so far away from Ground Zero, although I was born in Manhattan. When the planes hit, I was in bed in my house in Malibu with my now wife, Erica, and we got a call, turn on the television. There'd been this awful plane crash, and then as the morning evolved, and it became clear that it was a terrorist attack and that the United States was at war, all I could do is try frantically to get back east, mainly because I had two teenage girls living here in Manhattan. I wanted very much to get into the story, but more than anything else, I was concerned about my own children. They go to school on the Upper East Side, and as it turns out, they closed Manhattan Island. They closed the bridges. They closed the tunnels. My kid's house on 93rd Street and Park Avenue became kind of the central gathering point for all their fellow students who lived in the outer boroughs and couldn't get home. So all the children were in the house on 93rd Street, and it was very difficult to reach them when I did get through to them. My then, now she's a teenager, then 6-year-old daughter Simone was crying about, "Dad, we can't get in the elevator because all those people died trying to get down from the elevator." And then as things evolved and, the day wore on, we came to realize that six of the dads in the school they had just moved from, Rumson Country Day, had perished. They worked for Cantor Fitzgerald or some of those other financial firms. So my daughters were again traumatized, not only by the emergency in Manhattan, but by the fact that so many of their friends' dads had died. And here I was in California, and I couldn't get home. I just couldn't get home. There was no way to get home. Finally, we came home through Canada and Connecticut and finally drove down. And by the time I got here, it was several days later. When the planes hit, I immediately was on the phone or communicating through our own methods with our bosses at NBC News. I was on the air at CNBC, had a great show, a very comfortable show. It was the highest rated show on the network. And I'm saying to my bosses, you got to get me to the war. I've got to get to Afghanistan. I've got to, be part of this effort now to make right what has been done to us. And they told me no, they wouldn't let me. I wasn't even on the air for the first couple of days because they preempted CNBC. So they preempted my show. They wouldn't let me leave. They wouldn't let me go to war, although I was one of the few people who had experience in Afghanistan and Pakistan and the tribal territories previously, mostly doing stories about heroin and opium and all the drug dealing and the other kind of war, the Soviet invasion of Afghanistan, etc. So I did have experience there, but they wouldn't let me go because they had war correspondents assigned. And I said, well, if you don't let me go, then I'm quitting. And that was very, very dramatic at the time. A lot of industry news about it. We did have, this powerful show. But I refused to be handcuffed to my desk. I had to get into the fray. So I called Roger Ailes, who had actually put me on the air at CNBC and had now moved to Fox News. And I said, Roger, if I quit NBC, will you hire me and make me a war correspondent? So to make a long story short, after, the war carrying on and seeing all the drama, I was very frustrated, chafing at the bit. Finally, I could get out of the NBC deal. I came over here on a Friday in mid-November. By the next Monday, I was in Islamabad in Pakistan. By the next Tuesday, I was in the Khyber Pass heading to the combat. And, that was 10 years ago. So it's been 10 years. And in the last 10 years, basically, I've been the senior war correspondent for Fox News. I've been in Afghanistan 10 extended, we call them deployments, assignments. 10 more in Iraq, and then in Somalia, in the Middle East, and every crap hole in between. 9/11 has been a very personal marker for lots of reasons. Not only the friends and close associates and parents of other students in the school that we lost, but also it changed our life. I had a very comfortable life at NBC. We could commute between my house in Malibu, which I no longer have because it was too far away from the action. I didn't ever want to be separated from my children by that kind of distance again. They live here in New York. So it changed my life. It made my life from a comfortable desk-bound anchorman to a globe-trotting, bullet-dodging war correspondent. And it's a much tougher life, obviously. It's been a stress and strain. not only the rigors of combat journalism, but also being away from your wife and children, and they're always so worried. And you get home from those assignments overseas, and I sit down and be drooling. I've lost so many soldiers and sailors, Marines, airmen, Coast Guardsmen that I've known. I have pictures on my wall in my office of me with GIs. You take a picture, and now they're dead, and their parents send me the photo back. It's been a very, very stressful time. It's been a 10 years of really unbelievable drama, high and low. And I have to tell you, the karma is interesting. What goes around comes around. The fact that I was out of pocket on 9/11 was more than repaid by the great spirits above, by God, whoever. I feel blessed by the fact that I was actually on the air when the news came that Osama bin Laden had been killed. And for me, that was like that chapter closing in a profound and dramatic personal way for me, because here was the devil that perpetrated this evil on my country, and more specifically on my circle of friends and close associates, and here he was dead, and we killed him. And it was, they talk about closure. Closure is a funny thing, and it's one of those cliches you hear in news and reality programs and, in pop cultural jargon, but there really was a sense, we got the bastard. And it really was such an amazing moment. And the fact that I could be on the air and deliver that message to the viewers who had seen the last decade of, the gunfire and the ups and downs and the terrible losses that we suffered in the war. And we all kind of sighed together. And, that's one for the good guys. I was in Washington just by chance because the White House Correspondents' Dinner was the night before. And in fact, I introduced Erica, my wife, to the President and First Lady there, and he was so cool, so calm. He was joking about Donald Trump, and it was a kind of event that seemed, so Washington and casual and social. And we came to realize later that he knew exactly what was going on. The operation was supposed to take out bin Laden that Saturday night, and because of weather, they postponed it. But the president knew exactly what was going on. So really, the fact that he didn't tip his hand, it could be so glib and funny and casual at that, I gained enormous respect for the president of the United States for that kind of performance. So I just happened to be there that Sunday. I had my boat on the Potomac River. So I said, okay, I'll stay another day in Washington. We'll do the show from Washington. So I got to the studio. The prep started around 9 o'clock Eastern time. And then around 9:45, 9:50, 10 minutes before I was scheduled to go on the air live at 10 o'clock Eastern time, came word that the President of the United States was going to address the American people at 10:30. So we sit back and say, 10:30 on a Sunday night? So it's not about the economy. It's not about anything normal, because that could wait for a briefing Monday morning. Why go on the air 10:30 Sunday night of all things? So then we started thinking, okay, what could it be? Okay, it could be an awful disaster. But wait a second, if it was an awful disaster, like another nuclear problem, a tsunami, some awful problem with all of our correspondents all over the world, we would have heard about it. We would know if it was something awful. Okay, so it's not something awful. It's probably something good. What could it be good? It has to be national security. Otherwise, again, it could wait. All right, so it's got to be Muammar Gaddafi. We bombed his compound, yesterday and the day before. He's going to announce that Gaddafi's dead. Okay, now we go on the air. It's 10 o'clock. So I've got Tom McInerney, the three-star retired Air Force general. I have him in the studio with me because I thought we were going to do a Libya story. And in fact, we had some Libya reports ready because I had just been there. We had some very, dramatic combat experience there. We got out. So I had General McInerney with me. So we're talking Gaddafi. And then about 10:15, we started thinking, Gaddafi's not that big. I mean, he's important, but he's strategically not that important. So now it's 10:15. So now, we start getting some internet chatter. My brother Craig is with me. We're running back and forth. The Twitter has gone, on fire. People are speculating all kinds of things. And then around 10:30, 10:35, Craig and I are looking at each other, and we say, it's Osama bin Laden, isn't it? It has to be. Who else could it be? 10:39, we went on the air and we said, That's who it is. It's Osama bin Laden. We got confirmation, you know, from our White House people and our Capitol Hill people, Todd Pergram, our senior producer at the Hill. He said it's Osama bin Laden. So there I was. I'm on the 1039, and we're way ahead of everybody else. We broke the news, I think, in mainstream media anyway. And to announce that, it's hard to recreate the amazing, cathartic emotion of that moment. Not only are you being a journalist and trying, you know, with little information to piece together a logical presentation and go with the best possible evidence and not raise people's hopes, and on the other hand, remembering the 10 years that I've spent chasing this son of a bitch. I chased him to Khartoum in the Sudan, to Jalalabad. I've been to three of his houses. We looked all over Tora Bora for him, recreated his escape route to Pakistan. It was really a very personal thing to me. And then the confirmation comes. So then you're a newsman, but you're also a person. You're also a person who has, you know, seen an amazing, dramatic chapter in his life come to an end. So you try your best not to make a fool of yourself. You know, not to make the dreaded Osama, Obama, you know, slip of the tongue, which I did at least once. And, you know, you present it as best you can, as logical a fashion as you can. And the way things turned out, I think it was my greatest night in my 42-year career. What happened to me, 9/11, I chose up sides, not only with my country, but I made sure that I was going to be the advocate for the military. That, you know, there's a real pacifist side of me and of America as well. There should be a reluctance to get involved in foreign adventures. And being a foreign correspondent in the 70s and the 80s, when the United States was not really engaged militarily in any substantial way, or even the 90s, you know, the military tended to have a back row in terms of the amount of attention they received. And I remember having lived through the Vietnam era, having been part of the anti-war movement, how the military was scorned, and how they became, you know, like public servants rather than exalted heroes. And having watched that and being extremely sensitive to that, and now being in the field with our GIs and having not really done that, although I got in on the tail end of the Vietnam, Cambodia, Laos stuff back in the early 70s. But this was really up close and personal with our GIs on a daily basis. I said, I'm going to be their advocate. I'm going to make sure they never again are scorned the way they were. I'm going to make sure that we recognize the sacrifice, not just of the combat heroes, you know, the very point of the spear, but all of these kids. You know, they get deployed overseas for a year. They're 19 years old. They got an 18-year-old wife. She's pregnant. You know, a year later, the baby's born. They haven't even seen the kid. They're getting paid, you know, less than the guy that drives a livery cab here in New York City. So that's what I became. I became, and I am very proud of that, very close to many of the members of the armed forces, guys I knew as privates or now master sergeants, people I met as lieutenants and captains and majors are now generals. They're in charge of huge divisions or branches of the military. Yeah, and I'm very proud of that. I want very much, if that's how people remember me when I finally end this long roller coaster career, I'd be honored by that.
Talk to me about the sort of iconic status that was the World Trade Center. You know, it was part of the New York skyline. Mm-hmm.
I live on the river, Hudson River, here in New York Harbor. I think I can say with confidence that of all recreational boaters within the 15 million people within 45 miles of the World Trade Center, I'm on the water more than anyone. I'm there constantly. I always give all my out-of-town visitors cruise past the World Trade Center, then to the Statue of Liberty, then back to my house up by the George Washington Bridge. To see it missing, all those long years when these dipshit politicians could not get their act together, and they laid cornerstone after cornerstone, and then they'd remove the corner and get all the publicity, and then remove the cornerstone, storm out at JFK Airport. They have one design, another design, all of these various special interest groups keeping this thing from being built. It was one of the most frustrating things of my life. You come into New York Harbor under the Verrazano Bridge, and the biggest building in the whole lower Manhattan section of town was a building in Jersey City. It was an obscenity how long it took and how this process. I mean, if Donald Trump had had it initially, the thing would have been up already. But finally, to make a long story short, now it's building and it's building apace. And to see it go up at one floor a week. And now it's the tallest building in lower Manhattan already. And I brought my boat there to North Cove, the little marina that's right there by the World Financial Center, where the World Trade Center looms once again right over the boat. And I took my five-year-old Erica and I, we went walking, and there it is. There's the World Trade Center. To actually see the tower growing and growing so beautifully, and the whole downtown area to be alive again. And it was a ghost town for years. People who lived in Battery Park City, for God's sakes. I mean, all they worried about was whether or not they had cancer from when the buildings went down. A lot of restaurants that started in Tribeca were dead for years. Now everything's thriving. West Broadway, all those streets, you know, packed with people. And to see it, at the same time, you remember that the guy that took it down is a goner now and that his organization is on the run. It really gives you faith in America. It really gives you a sense of confidence in the future. Now, if they just get this budget deal patched together and get working again, that would be good. But yeah. In terms of the World Trade Center, things are great. We always used to have breakfast at Windows on the World. We used to love the shops in the basement of the World Trade Center. It was a city. People have to realize, particularly those who have never seen it or not been downtown, it was like the Minneapolis Mall of America, the world's largest. This was the Mall of America underground, under those towers. And, you know, I have a dear cousin of mine who works for the Port Authority. You know, he was there in 93 when they tried to bomb the damn thing with the truck bomb. He was there again. This time, fortunately, he was in a lower floor with the Port Authority, so he wasn't hurt. But it was a city within a city. Thriving, you know, mini metropolis right there underground. You had the PATH trains, you had the subways, you had all of the communication interface. You had people from all over. You had all that international crew in the towers themselves. And to see it from the water, to see that iconic, those iconic towers, the Twin Towers, it was kind of like the Statue of Liberty or the Empire State Building in the sense that it became representative, not just of New York, but of the new world, you know, the capital, the confident capital of everything we all stand for. Anyone who has any progressive bone in their body stands for. And to see it humbled, to see it taken down, first of all, and no one says this, it was a brilliant military move by the terrorists. They knew how to hurt us, and they hurt us grievously. But now we have won. The towers are going back up, and they're dead.